Good morning all. Today we are going on to the next session of our module 6, that is power system stability. And today what we are going to discuss on, we are going to discuss more on the steady state stability limit, and we have to discuss on what is the equation for finding out steady state stability limit, what is the condition for a system to be remain in the steady state condition, and what are the methods to improve the steady state stability. Okay, so now I'm just going on to the summary of the last class. Last class we have studied on the swing equation. In that swing equation for a single machine system, swing equation PA is equal to M into D square delta by DT square, where this delta is the rotor angle with reference to the rotating reference axis, delta, and M is the inertia constant. Okay, and we can say PA is the accelerating power. In case of alternator, it will be PM minus PE, or in case of motor, it will be PE minus PA. That depends upon the input minus output. Okay, accelerating power. And what was the swing equation? That also we have studied. Swing equation is a second order differential equation which relates or which describes the relative portion, relative position or relative motion of the rotor axis with reference to the stationary rotate, with reference to the synchronous rotating axis as a function of time. I repeat once more, swing equation is a differential equation which describes the relative position of a rotor angle with reference to the synchronous rotating axis as a function of time. And the mathematical representation is PA is equal to M into D square delta by DT square. From the swing equation we can draw a swing curve. What is a swing curve? Swing curve is the relation between, or the plot between, the rotor angle delta and time as a function of time on real axis. Okay, so to explain the swing curve, this was my initial system, that is delta node, when my system was under normal condition or normal operating condition or operating equilibrium. At that time, after some time, the fault occurs, and as a result of this, my rotor angle increases to a delta delta value and it starts oscillating. Okay, if the system to be stable, then the oscillation should be damped out with the help of a damping torque, that we will discuss in this class. And I also discussed on the multi-machine system. We know that the swing equation is a second order differential equation. So solving it for a multi-machine system is little tedious, so we can't go for it. But still, just I'll give some with a reference to two machine system. So for a two machine system, we are considering two cases, coherent operation and non-coherent operation, or incoherent operation. For coherent operation, all the machines will be working in synchronism, or the rotor angle delta will be equal. At that case, we can say M equivalent into D square delta by DT square is equal to P equivalent PM equivalent minus PE equivalent, where M equivalent, we can just sum up the inertia constant M1 plus M2 into D square delta by DT square is equal to PM equivalent, is just sum up PM1 and PM2. And for PE equivalent also, we can just sum up PE1 and PE2. While it is working in incoherent operation, that is, one machine will be in generator and one machine will be motor. Incoherent operation means the machines will be working with a different delta angle, different voltage angles. So what will happen? The power will flow from higher delta to lower delta. The power will flow from higher delta value to the lower delta value. Here I am assuming G1 is having higher delta, so my power will flow from here to here, that is, this machine will work as a generator and here it will work as a motor. Okay, so if there is a lossless system I am considering, then I can write my swing equation like this, that is M equivalent into D square by DT square of delta 1 minus delta 2, that M equivalent will be equal to M1 M2 divided by M1 plus M2 is equal to PM equivalent minus PE1, because power is delivered by G1, so minus PE1. From this we can find out the power delivered. Okay, power delivered to the motor. So this was the swing equation. And also, if we are given this M and we are asked to find out our per unit inertia constant, then we can transfer that is m is equal to gh by pi f. From that we can do our calculations. I hope you remember all those things. So today what I am going to discuss is on powers, that is on steady state stability limits. Okay, so we are going on to discuss on our steady state stability limit. Before going on discussing on the steady state stability limit, I just want you to remember what is a steady state stability. That is, a steady state stability is a system is having steady state stable condition when it regains to the normal operating condition after a small disturbance. Steady state disturbance or steady state stability relates to a small disturbance. Okay, so steady state stability, it will be all the system will regain after a small disturbance, or the disturbance or size of the disturbance will be very low, or the time period will also be very low. So if I am going to discuss on, then I am drawing in my generator, that is my generator E angle delta, and it is connected to a transmission line through my infinite bus bar. Here I am taking as V angle 0, that is, this is my infinite bus bar, or in some textbook you will draw like this, and this is the transmission line reactance X. Okay, so what is the power, what is the power transferred? The power, electrical power transferred will be sending end voltage into receiving end voltage into sine delta divided by the transmission line counts reactance X. Okay, so this equation is for a cylindrical rotor. Okay, so first my system was working in a steady state. At that condition, I can say this was my initial condition PE0, that is equal to EV sine, initial delta was delta 0, isn't it? I have drawn, initially it was delta 0, sine delta 0 divided by X. We know that this should be a constant, the terminal voltage should be a constant, then generating voltage will be constant, reactance will be constant. So I can write it as these three are constant. So I am writing it as P max, because this the energy power transferred will be maximum when delta naught value will be 90 degree. Sine delta, sine 90 is 1, then PE naught will be maximum when EV by X happens. Okay, so I am replacing EV by X as P max. So I can write it as P max sine delta 0. So if you are asked to find out in the question, okay, in the question find out delta naught, then we can easily say delta naught is equal to sine inverse of PE0 divided by Pmax, or PE divided by Pmax. Okay, and also we should know that in our steady state operation PA is equal to 0, which means that our mechanical power, this is working as an alternator, no? So PM minus PE is the accelerating power for an alternator. So PA is equal to 0 means PM is equal to PE. At the initial condition, what is PE? That is equal to PE0. So I can say in initial condition PM is equal to PE0. This was my initial operating condition, PM is equal to PE0, and my angle delta was a constant, or it was synchronous, it is rotating at a constant speed, the machine was rotating at a constant speed. So when it was working at that time, what happened is a disturbance occurred. Okay, so some small disturbance, we should remember that steady state stability is related to small disturbance only. So what happened, a small disturbance occurred. As a result of this disturbance, my delta changed to a new delta value, that is, this is my new delta value. That new delta I can write after disturbance, I can say my new delta is equal to my previous delta 0 plus a change in delta angle, that is delta 0 plus delta delta. So if I am writing this in my equation, then I can say my present electrical power transferred is equal to E into V divided by x ev by x into sine of this delta, instead of delta 0, this is delta 0 plus delta value. Okay, so what happens? That is, I can write it as p max into sine delta 0 plus delta. Okay, so I am employing my equation, that is sine a plus b is equal to sine a cos b plus cos a sine b. So I can write it as p max into sine a cos b plus cos a sine b. Sin a cos b plus cos a sin b. I can write my equation like this. So if I am writing this, then that is equal to, we know the disturbance is small disturbance. So what will happen to this delta? This angle will also be small. Because small disturbance, the angle variation will be very small. So delta is small. So as we have done in our power system load flow studies, we can say cos delta, this delta angle is very small, no? So cos 0, the value will be approximately 1. And what will happen to sin delta? The sin delta value is also very low. So I can rewrite it as delta. If I am rewriting the same, then I can say that is p max into sin delta 0 into cos delta, that is 1 itself, plus cos delta 0 into sine delta. I can write it as delta. Okay, so I can write this. Then, so my equation will be p max sine delta 0 plus p max delta into cos delta 0. Okay, so PE is equal to p max sine delta 0. We already know what is p max sine delta 0, that we have already studied. That is PE 0. That is equal to PE 0 plus p max delta cos delta 0. So how can we write it? So we have to find out what is p max cos delta 0. So if I am writing here, if PE is equal to, we know p max sine delta 0, then what is cos delta 0? That is equal to dou PE by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0. Okay? Then it will be P max into differential of sine. It is cos, no? So P max into cos delta 0. So I can rewrite my equation as, PE is equal to P max sine delta 0, isn't it? So P max sine delta 0 is PE 0 plus this delta I am taking out. Delta into dou PE by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0. So this is my equation, that is, this PE is the new electrical power. This PE is the new electrical power is equal to the initial power plus delta into dou PE by dou delta into delta 0. Okay, so this is the equation. So I should write that PE is equal to the new electrical power. It is the new electrical power after disturbance. PE 0 is the initial electrical power. PE 0 is the initial electrical power that was before our disturbance. Okay, and what is delta is the change in rotor angle. Delta is the change in rotor angle after disturbance. Okay, so delta is the change in the rotor angle after disturbance, and you know delta 0 is the initial rotor angle before disturbance. So this is the equation we got in. Now what is our problem is, we know that PE, what is this PE? PE PE is equal to P0 plus delta delta plus. Then what we have to do is we have to substitute this in swing equation to find out the stability, isn't it? So we don't know what is PE, we don't know, and what is this delta delta also we don't know. So we have to find out some solution for this delta delta. We have to find out how, what is the steady state stability limit of the system for the change of this delta delta value. So to find out this delta delta, what I am going to do is I am going to substitute in our swing equation. Our swing equation was m into d square delta by dt square is equal to Pm minus Pe. Your machine is a alternator, no? So m into d square delta by dt square is equal to Pm minus Pe. So if I am substituting this Pe value here, that is equal to Pm minus Pe0 P, you know, plus delta delta into dou Pe divided by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0. I can substitute like this. So if I am writing this, that is equal to Pm minus Pe0 minus delta delta into dou Pe by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0. That is equal to m into d square delta by dt square. Now we don't know this delta and we don't know this delta delta angle. Okay. So we have to find out a solution for this. For that, first we should know that we already assumed that in initial state, that is my machine. Our assumption is we are not changing our mechanical power input, that Pm is a constant and it will be equal to our initial power Pe0. So this minus this will be 0, no? So I can write it as m into d square delta divided by dt square is equal to minus delta delta into dou Pe by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0 initial condition. So this is well my equation. So what we have to do is we have to solve for our delta delta value. Okay, so what is the relation between this delta and delta delta? We have to prove it. Okay, so we know that what is this delta value? Our present delta value is equal to delta 0 initial plus delta delta value, isn't it? So if I am finding out dou delta by dou delta by dou t, if I am differentiating my angle with a reference to time, then I can say this delta 0 was a constant. So I can say that is equal to dou delta delta divided by dou t. Okay. And if I am again, we have to find out dou square delta by dt square. We can't keep both this together, because either we have to find this delta or we have to change in terms of delta delta. So what I am going to do, I am finding out dou square delta by dou dt square, that will be equal to d square delta delta divided by dt square. If it is like that, then I can substitute, instead of this d square delta by dt square, I can substitute this value, isn't it? So I am substituting this. Wait a minute, I have to take a paper. Okay, so if I am substituting this, then I can write m into d square delta delta divided by dt square is equal to, what is it, minus delta delta into dou Pe divided by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0. If I am solving this, then I can write m into d square delta delta divided by dt square plus delta delta into dou Pe divided by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0 is equal to 0. This is the equation I got it. This is a second order differential equation, that is dou square dou delta divided by dt square plus delta delta. So I got a second order differential equation in terms of this delta delta. Okay, I am getting a second order differential equation in terms of this delta delta. So how will we solve this? So in order to carry it into a second order differential equation, I am rewriting it as, so dou square delta delta divided by dou t square, I can write it as capital D, plus
दो प्लस डेल्टा डेल्टा. सो इफ आई एम राइटिंग दिस ओनली देन आई हैव टू रिप्लेस इट इज़न्ट इट. सो दो पीई बाई दो डेल्टा at delta is equal to delta 0 is equal to 0. Okay, so if by m, okay, so it is very difficult to write it as such, isn't it? Dou p by dou delta by delta is equal to delta 0. I feel it difficult to write it, and also we should know this is differential of pi pe divided by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0. So this was the initial condition, and at the initial condition it was a constant, so I can consider this as a constant, and I am rewriting my equation as dou square delta divided by dt square plus delta delta by m, and I am replacing it with a constant. So I am writing it as k. I am replacing it with a constant k is equal to m, where my capital K is equal to dou PE by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0. Okay, so this I can write it as, this is of the form, this is of the form, that is differential form, d square delta. I can write it as capital D. Okay, capital D plus K by M into, this is the variable, partial differential variable, delta delta is equal to 0. Okay, or d square, isn't it? So I should write d square plus k by m into delta delta is equal to 0. This is a second order differential equation. So we should consider whether this can be 0 or this term can be 0. Delta delta cannot be 0. If delta delta is 0, means no disturbance has occurred. So this cannot be 0. From this I can write d square plus k by m can be equal to 0. What is it? D square plus k by m can be equal to 0, or d square can be plus or minus k by m, or I can write it as d is equal to plus or minus root of d is equal to plus or minus root of k by m. Okay, here one minus is also there, because if I am taking it outside, d square is equal to minus k by m, no? Then d is equal to plus or minus root of minus k by m. This will be the root. Okay, if this is the root, then we have to find out what, depending upon this, m is an inertia constant, it will be a constant, and depending upon the value of k and m, we have to determine whether a system is a constant or not with reference to the second order equation. No, we have to consider. So first what I have to consider is, we know the root of d, or what is this d? The root of delta value, delta value, that value, or dou delta by dou t value, that is equal to plus or minus root of minus k by m. Okay, so I hope you understood until now. Next we are moving on to, we are substituting different values. We are assuming if the value is positive, what will happen? If the value is negative, what will happen? And if the value is equal to 0, what will happen? From this we can understand, when d square plus k by m is equal to 0, that means no disturbance has occurred, or the system will be in a original condition. So first I am assuming my case 1, I am assuming, what should I assume? I am assuming this k value is negative. Okay, I am assuming k value is negative, that is k value is less than 0. What will happen if k value is less than 0? That is dou pe by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0 will be less than 0. What it means, if it is less than 0, then k value is less than 0, then this minus and minus, no, that will become positive. So root of k by m will be a positive value, isn't it? Root of k by m will be a positive value. If it is a positive value, then what will be the solution? Our this d will have equal and real roots, equal and real roots, isn't it? We will get equal and real roots. Then what we have to do here? If it is positive, then d is equal to equivalent real roots. And what will be the solution if the roots are equal? That is, if the root is plus or minus m, then we can write it as the solution should be, what is the solution? Delta delta here, isn't it? Or if we are taking x, if the root is plus or minus m, then we can write it as x is equal to c1 e raised to minus mt plus c2 e raised to mt, right? Like that we used to write, no? So in this case, if I am writing, then I can say delta delta was my x value. Okay, delta delta is equal to c1 what e raised to minus mt, that is here a root is root of k by m, k by m into t, isn't it, plus c2 into e raised to minus root of k by m into t. Okay, so this will be the solution for the equation, which means that exponential root, isn't it? So what will happen if I am drawing the curve? Then if I am drawing the curve, I make you remember of my swing curve, that is t, and this was my delta zero value, and it increased to a value delta delta, isn't it? So this was my delta zero value, and this is my delta delta value, delta delta axis. So delta delta is exponentially increasing, so my curve will be like this. So which means that the system is not stable, the system is unstable. So we have to remember, the system is unstable when, in the case one, when my k value is less than 0. And in case 2, I am assuming that my value, that k value is positive. If my k value, that is d, is equal to, if my k value is positive, then d should be equal to plus or minus root of minus k by m, isn't it? One minus k will come, okay, this minus term will come. So as a result, what will be the root? The root will be that is, if my value of k is greater than 0, then my dou pe by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0 should be greater than 0. Or my, here it will be positive only, no? So root of minus, the roots will be, what are the roots? The roots here will be complex, okay? Roots will be complex. And what will be the roots? That is equal to, that d root will be plus or minus j into root of k by m. This will be the root. Plus or minus 1, j term will come, because one minus is there, na? Root of minus 1, that is j term will come. Okay, so then we have to write our equation as delta delta is equal to, then j term comes, then e raised to j theta we have to substitute. So c1 cos of root k by m into t plus c2 sin root k by m into t. This should be our equation when it is an complex root. Okay, so what will happen if I am drawing the same swing equation, swing curve, then this is t and this is my delta angle, and this was my initial delta 0. And what will happen if my delta delta value is increasing? Then my swing curve will increase, and it will come like this, like this, like this. Curve will be there. Okay, so my swing curve will be here. So we can say this can be a marginally stable state, we can say, because if this value is less than my delta maximum, delta maximum is 90 degree, no? So if this value is less than delta maximum, then the system will be stable, otherwise the system will be unstable. So I hope we have discussed on our initial condition that in mechanics of solids, that we are representing the mechanical component into depending upon the moment of inertia, that is j d square theta by dt square, and then we have to consider friction or damming, that is d theta by dt. this thing we have ignored in our last class. I hope you remember that this equation we have ignored. We said we are just ignoring the damping. So in this condition, if my k value is greater than 0, or though PE by dou delta at delta 0, that we have to find out that what was PE. PE was P max into sin delta 0. So dou PE by dou delta 0 sin delta, dou PE by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0 means that is P max cos delta 0 value. Okay, that value should be greater than 0. This value should be greater than 0 means cos delta 0 will be greater than 0 when delta 0 value is from 0 to 90 degree. Cos 0 is 1 and cos 90 is 0. Okay, so it should be in between. Delta 0 should be 0 and 90 degree. Okay, and in that case, if my damping ratio or damping constant, if my system has a damping capability, then we can sustain or we can damp, not sustain, we can damp our oscillations like this. So this is real time t, and this was my delta 0, and if I have a damping ability, then after some delta my system will go on and damp. Okay, and the system will become stable. Okay, if there is enough damping capability, then my system can be stable. Okay, and then what will be the oscillations? Then we know cos omega t should come in cos omega t, you know. So we have to find out our frequency of oscillations. Wait a minute, I'll take one more paper. So we have two cases, that is we have three cases. Our system can be unstable, marginally stable, or stable. Okay, so and the oscillations, the frequency of the oscillations will be, what will be the frequency of oscillation? That is also very important. So we have to study. So we used to determine like cos omega t, you know. Here we know omega is equal to root of k by m, isn't it? Omega is equal to root of k by m, or if I am rewriting it, what was k? K was dou PE divided by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0 divided by my moment of inertia constant m. Okay, so if I am substituting for this, then if I am substituting for this using swing equation, then I can write it as, it will be root of dou PE divided by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0 divided by what is m? M was gh by pi f. So I can write like this also. Okay, so this is the frequency. So how can we find out our omega? We can find out our frequency of oscillation, that is 2 pi f. From any of this equation we can find out omega is equal to 2 pi f. So that is, we get from here. Okay, or if you are asked to find out the value in h per unit, then how can we solve it? If we are asked to find out in per unit, then we can write it as dou PE by dou delta at delta 0. This will come up pi f divided by h per unit. Okay, here instead of h it will become h per unit. Okay, so I have to summarize it. What are the different stability criteria of or what are the different steady state stability criteria? Okay, it depends upon the value of dou PE by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0. It depends upon the value of dou PE by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0. Okay, if the value of dou PE by dou delta, case 1, if the value of dou PE by dou delta is greater than 0, which means that dou PE by dou delta is greater than 0 means that cos delta 0 value, P max cos delta 0 value is P max cos delta 0 value is greater than 0, or for that our delta 0 value should be in between 0 and 90 degree. It should be in between 0 and 90 degree. If my delta 0 value is in between 0 and 90 degree, we can say our system is a stable system. If my delta value is between 0 and 90 degree, then we can say our system is a stable system. And in the second case, if my dou PE by dou delta at delta is equal to delta 0 is less than 0, that means, which means my P max cos delta 0 value is less than 0, which means that then delta 0 value should be in between 90 and 180 degree. Then delta 0 value should be in between 90 and 180 degree. At that time, my system will be unstable. And next is when it becomes dou PE by dou delta is equal to 0, then we can say our P max cos delta 0 is equal to 0, or I can say when will it become equal to 0? Cos 90 is equal to 0. So delta 0 should be equal to 90 degree, then my system will be marginally stable. So these are the three conditions for our system to be stable. Also, if from our power angle curve, I hope you remember our power angle curve, that is here electrical power and here was the angle delta, and our power angle curve was like this. That is, it will happen maximum power, it will happen at 90 degree, and here it is pi. Zero, or here it is pi by 2, I can write it as. So if my angle delta is between 0 and 90 degree, this region is the stable region and this is the unstable region. That is why in the second part of the lecture I told you, if the delta angle is between 0 and 90 degree, the system will be stable. Or I should say, here from here I should say, our machine is working as a generator, no? So PM minus PE is the equation. Our machine is working as a generator, so PM minus PE, input minus output, should be greater than 0 if it is in an accelerating mode. I want to say is, if my, this is my power of a generator, we are in giving, that is mechanical power, isn't it? So this is PE, is my system power or the output power. If the system power is greater than this machine power, or the system requires more power than the generator, then my system will collapse or my system will be unstable when the accelerating power is greater than the maximum power. Then the system will be collapse. So the maximum stable, I'll write maximum stable state stability limit is corresponds to the value P max. Okay, if the system, this value, it can go up to P max. After P max, my system will be unstable. Okay, so the maximum power it can transfer is up to P max when sine delta is equal to 1, that is at 90 degree. After that, our system will collapse. Okay, so this is a different criteria for our stability, different stability criteria for assessing whether our system will be stable or not. Okay, so based on this, we usually get a question for our GATE exam. Next, we have to discuss on the different methods of improving our steady state stability limit. Okay, so what are the different methods to improve steady state stability? Different different methods to improve steady state stability. So what is the power transfer equation? That was E into V into sine delta divided by x for a cylindrical part. Okay, so this was our power transfer equation, PE, electrical power transfer. We also know that this terminal voltage should be kept constant, isn't it? This voltage should be constant. The load end voltage should be constant. So, and this other parameter, three parameters, we can vary and we can increase our power transfer capability. So, we, in order to improve the power steady state stability, we have to increase our maximum power transfer capability. So, Pmax should be improved. Pmax should be improved so as to improve the stability limit. Okay, how can we increase our Pmax? So that we are going to study. Okay, so first method we can is, method one is we can increase our E value, or we can increase our excitation. We can increase our excitation or E value. If my excitation is increased, what will happen? That is, my EMF will also increase. So EMF will increase. That means our power transfer capability, it is producing over EMF. Okay, or I can say, if my system is working in overexcited region, I can improve my stability. Overexcited region, first method. And in the second method we can do is, then we have increased this E. Next is, we should reduce this X. Okay, reactance. Reactance of the line. How can we reduce reactance? Reactance X. So how can we reduce this reactance? X should be reduced. Reactant should be reduced by, we have studied in our PGTP, power generation transmission. We can reduce the reactance of a transmission by bundling of conductors, isn't it? By bundling of conductors, we can reduce our reactance. Again, we can use parallel conductors. We can use parallel lines to reduce our conductors, or we will say double circuit. We can provide double circuit lines to produce the reactants. Or what is reactants? Here reactants comes to XL, no? So in order to reduce the total reactants, we know R plus X, this X value can be reduced by adding a capacitance in series. That is, XL, if we are adding a capacitance in series, then XL value can be reduced. So the third method is the series compensation method. We are adding capacitors. Okay, so that the reactance of the transmission line can be reduced. Okay, so by these methods we can reduce the reactance. Next, how can we use this? We have to improve the voltage. We have to improve by using a static VAR compensator. By using SVC is a static VAR compensator. I think we have studied it in our facts class. So static VAR compensator, static VAR compensator. So what is the speciality of the static VAR compensator? Static VAR compensators inject reactive power. Why should we inject reactive power? So if we inject the reactive power, then our voltage profile will be enhanced. Voltage profile will be enhanced, or we can say SVC. If we are adding SVC, it won't consume any real power. So it won't consume any real power. Without consuming any real power, it is providing or it is injecting reactive power. So if we are injecting reactive power, what will happen? The voltage profile will be increased, so that our power transfer capability can be increased. Okay, like that we can also do. So I don't want to repeat our facts class. By adding an SVC, we are actually increasing the power transfer capability of our system. This is without a power curve, without a SVC, and this will be with the SVC, the power transfer capability will be highly increased when this changes, because if you are adding a compensator in between, this is a line and this is the motor. If we are adding an SVC here, then the power transfer capability, that PE equation will be E into V into sine, here the angle in between, no? So sine delta by 2 divided by, what is this, if it was x then it will be x by 2, that is 2 into P max into sine delta by 2. The power transfer capability is enhanced twice if we are adding an SVC in the middle of the transmission line. So these are the three main methods to improve our steady state stability. That is, first, by operating the synchronous machine in an overexcited region, and second one is we have to reduce the reactance of the conductor by either by bundling or parallel, using parallel circuit or giving series compensation, and we can use static VAR compensators to improve the power transfer capability, and hence we can improve the steady state stability. Okay, that's all for our today's portion. So we have completed with our steady state stability criterion, types of steady state stability, steady state stability limit. We already know the limit is up to maximum P max value. We should also remember that the steady state stability limit range is larger than the transient state stability limit. So in the next class, we will move on to our analysis of the transient stability with the help of equal area criterion. Okay, so since we have completed our steady state stability, I wanted to take a short test paper on our steady state stability area up to this module 6. The questions will be individual questions, and I will post in our Google Classroom. The exam will be scheduled on next Saturday. The session is on 2:30, I think. So I will post the question by 2:15, and you can start your examination at 2:30, and up to 3:30 you can write the examination, and after that we will have a short discussion. Okay, thank you. Happy learning. Have a great day.